The opening shot of the game is a visual of hundreds of Templars and mages headed towards a central location. Suddenly, a large explosion envelops the screen. We cut to our player character in a void of green energy. While exploring the area, you are chased by monsters. In the distance, you see a woman glowing in a bright green light. You reach out to her, but then you suddenly are teleported to the real world and go unconscious. You awaken to find yourself bound in chains. You look down at your hand and it sparks a green crackling energy. Two women walk into the room and begin to interrogate you. One of them asks why they should not kill you now, as she explains that the conclave was destroyed and everyone who attended it is dead except for you. They believe you responsible, and their only clue being that you were the only survivor and the green energy sparking from your hand. Your interrogator brings you outside to see what destruction she believes you're responsible for. The sky has been ripped apart and a green energy pulses towards the earth. She calls it the Breach, a portal connecting their world to the world of demons. This breach appeared as a result of the explosion at the conclave. The woman explains that every time the breach expands, the mark on your hand expands as well, and it is slowly killing you. She suggests that if you want to prove your innocence, to come with her to the breach, as she believes the two may be connected. On the way, she explains that the conclave was a gathering set up by their leader, Divine Justinia. It was supposed to be a peaceful gathering between Templars and mages who have been warring against each other. Now, most leaders on both sides have perished in the explosion. Eventually, you come upon a smaller rift and help a dwarf and mage fend off demons. Once the battle is over, the mage grabs your hand and points it at the rift. It closes. You're surprised by this, but you're now aware that you can help with the situation. The two introduce themselves to you. Varric is a dwarf from the city of Kirkwall, who is being brought to Divine Justinia for questioning. Solas is a mage not associated with the Chantry. He was the one who analyzed your mark and kept it from killing you while you slept. He was also the one who came up with the theory that whatever created the breach also marked you. Solas is an apostate mage who regularly explores the Fade, the world where demons and spirits come from. This world is where spellcasters pull their abilities from. An apostate mage is someone who is not part of the Circle of Magi, the official organization in the land that trains mages. These mages are watched and monitored by the Templar Order, as having magic abilities makes a person prone to possession from demons in the Fade. But after the destruction of the Chantry in Kirkwall, all-out war has broken out.
The Grand Cleric cannot help you.
Explain yourself, mage.
I will not stand by and watch you treat all mages like criminal, while those who would lead us bow to their Templar jailers.
How dare you speak to me?
The Circle has failed us, Orsino. Even you should be able to see that. The time has come to act. There can be no half measures. There can be no turning back.
Solas turns to your captor. He reveals her name is Cassandra and mentions to her that the breach is like nothing he's ever seen before. He suggests that you are innocent, as he believes it's unlikely any mage or non-mage to have this much power to cause what he is seeing. She understands, and the party heads to ground zero of the explosion. At the top, echoes of the past begin to play out near the central rift. We can see the image of a shadowy figure binding Divine Justinia. In this vision, Divine Justinia sees you and tells you to run and warn everyone. The flashback ends, but you have no memory of these events. Solas explains that the rift is causing echoes of what happened there, but it is incomplete. He then suggests to reopen and close the rift with the mark in order to properly seal it. Doing this will get the attention of the demons in the rift. A battle breaks out against a horde of demons, and you are successful in sealing it. Once the rift is sealed, you black out. You wake up to a woman tending to you in a room. She explains that it has been 3 days since you closed the rift, and the breach up top has stopped growing. You are then summoned to meet Cassandra at once. You walk into the room as she is arguing with Chancellor Roderick. He wants you taken to the capital of Val Royal to have you executed. Cassandra and Spymaster Liliana disregard his nagging, explaining that everyone who survived the explosion is a suspect. Clearly, Divine Justinia had enemies. You are no longer under suspicion, being believed to be a savior sent by the Maker. The people are calling you the Herald of Andraste. Cassandra then exclaims to the Chancellor by throwing down an old tome on the table, claiming it to be a writ from the Divine, granting Cassandra and Liliana the authority to act. Thus, she announces to him that she will revive the Inquisition and vows to seal the breach for good and find out those who were responsible for the massacre, with or without the approval of the remaining members of the Chantry. Liliana explains that the Inquisition was a group of people that banded together to restore order in the world gone mad, many years ago preceding the creation of the Chantry. Afterwards, they eventually laid down their banner and formed the Templar Order, known today. But Cassandra believes the Templar Order has lost its way, and someone else must lead. With no support from the Chantry, and with the mages and Templars at each other's throats, you, Cassandra, and Liliana revive the Inquisition. The Inquisition's first goal is to completely seal the breach once and for all. Solas believes that a second attempt should close it for good, so long as they amass enough magical power for your mark. The same amount of magical power that opened the breach in the first place. In the Inquisition War Room, options begin to be discussed on how to get enough magical power to close the breach. Your War Room consists of you and Cassandra, Liliana in charge of intelligence, Josephine in charge of diplomacy, and Cullen in charge of the army. Everyone believes that the best option is to get help from either the Templars or the mages, but having any discussions with them are impossible, while the Chantry has publicly denounced the Inquisition as blasphemy and everyone in the organization as heretics. After the first attempt at closing the breach, the people saw the miracle you pulled off, and soon word began to spread that you were the Herald of Andraste. The remaining Chantry members fear the following you're gathering. Liliana suggests you speak to a cleric in the hinterlands that wanted to meet you. Maybe she can help get into better favor with the Chantry. The Hinterlands is a war zone between Templars and mages, many citizens getting caught in the crossfire. You meet the cleric and healer, Mother Giselle. She suggests that the Chantry has only ever heard tales of terror of you, and those tales are coming from those who are grandstanding, wishing to become the next divine. She believes that the next best course of action is to head to Val Royeau and meet with them directly, to show them that you are no monster to be feared. In Val Royeau, when you arrive, the town is abuzz. You're informed by an Inquisition member that the Chantry Mothers await your arrival, but Templars have arrived to meet you in the market. In the market, a Chantry Mother is found riling up the crowd against you. She tries to sic nearby Templars on you to take you in, but then the Templar leader, Lord Seeker Lucius, arrives and has the Mother knocked out. It's a show of strength, as he shows he is the one with the power now, and considers the heretical Inquisition an annoyance at most. Sandra attempts to address the Lord Seeker, but he ignores her and leaves the area. She believes that the Lord Seeker is acting strangely, but it seems like nothing more will be accomplished in Val Royeau, so you head back. But just before you leave, you're met by the leader of the Mage Rebellion, and she asks you to meet her in Redcliff. In Redcliff, you get into contact with the Mage leader, but she has no recollection of setting up a meeting with you. Something is off, as you're informed that the mages are now indentured to the Taventer Empire for protection, and that they must work for them for 10 years to become full citizens with rights. While in Redcliff, you meet a Taventer mage named Dorian. He warns you of a cult sprouting around Taventer called the Venatori, and word is that they're currently trying to get at the Herald of Andraste. You are now given a choice to either continue investigating the mages and the Venatori, or to continue to gain favor of the Templar Order. No matter the choice, you are helped by either the Templars or mages to finally seal the breach in the sky. But victory is short-lived, as your base is attacked by an army seemingly out of nowhere. An archdemon soars through the sky, and out in the battlefield, you can see the one they call the Elder One, whom the Venatori worship. you are outnumbered and caught by surprise. At most, you can do is go down swinging. A wounded Chancellor Roderick tells you of a hidden path not known by anyone but he, as he is the only remaining survivor that would. He believes that it is the will of the Maker giving him a message. Cullen leads the survivors to escape, while you make a last-ditch effort to delay their forces. As you're taking control of the trebuchet, the archdemon swoops down and entraps you. The Elder One then arrives to meet you face to face. He has been chasing you down to remove the anchor. He holds up a magical orb and attempts to remove your mark. He claims that it is all your fault, that you interrupted his plan that fateful day at the Conclave. But instead of dying, you accidentally took the anchor to the rifts.
I do not know how you survived, but what marks you was touched, what you flail and rifts, I crafted to assault the very heavens. And you used the anchor to undo my work. The Gaul. I once breached the Fade in the name of another to serve the old gods of the Empire in person. I found only chaos and corruption, dead whispers. For 1,000 years I was confused, no more. I have gathered the will to return under no name but my own, to champion Withered Tevinter and correct this blighted world. Beg that I succeed, for I have seen the throne of the gods, and it was empty.
He is ultimately unsuccessful in taking back the anchor, and claims it's permanent. Before he can kill you, you successfully set off the trebuchet, causing a massive landslide. The archdemon picks up the Elder One and flies away, while you fall into an underground shaft. You eventually make it out of the snowy mountains until you're found by your companions. When you awake, Solus explains that the orb Corypheus carried was of elven make, and it was that which he used to open the rift. Unlocking it must have caused the explosion that destroyed the Conclave. The Elder One's name is Corypheus, a Tevinter mage from long ago. In legend, it is said that the Maker turned its back from the world after the mages peered too far into the Fade. As punishment, the world was beset by the Blight. Corypheus claims that he was one of those mages and is certain there are no gods in this world, as their seats were empty. Instead, he wishes to make himself a god and revive the old Tevinter Empire. Solus encourages you to lead the survivors further north, claiming there's a new place they can call home. Morale is low. Many have died. The Inquisition continues to hold out onto hope, continuing to believe in the Herald of Andraste. The remaining survivors of the Inquisition begin to renovate their new home, Skyhold, a fortress in the mountains that seems to have been abandoned for some time since after the Third Blight. Stories of the events at Haven have quickly spread, reigniting the people's belief in the Inquisition. People from all over are making the pilgrimage to Skyhold to join you against Corypheus. After everything that has happened, Cassandra and the others are convinced that you are the one that should lead the Inquisition, as it was your decisions and will that have taken them so far. Many in the Inquisition owe you their lives after the events in Haven and vow to follow you to the end. With your council, you discuss Corypheus and try to make sense of what he wants and who he is. The council can't figure out much, but they do know what he wants next. When helping the mages or Templars, you uncover a scheme to assassinate the Empress of Orlais. They believe that the chaos caused by her death would destabilize the area, making it much easier for Corypheus to invade with his army. During the discussions, Varric walks into the room, claiming he knows someone who can help, saying his friend has crossed paths with Corypheus before, and may have more insight on what he will do next. You follow Varric alone to a secluded part of Skyhold, and meet his contact. His friend is named Hawk, the famed champion of Kirkwall and protagonist of Dragon Age 2. Hawk informs you about his encounter with Corypheus. Corypheus was imprisoned by the Grey Wardens, but while in his jail, he used his connection to the Blight to cause infighting amongst the Wardens and drive them mad. Hawk was then lured into his prison by corrupt Wardens. Trapped in the prison, the only way to escape was to kill Corypheus. Hawk and his team thought the job was done, but clearly Corypheus has some sort of power of resurrection. Now realizing that Corypheus was most likely imprisoned because he couldn't be killed. When they initially met Corypheus, he seemed confused. Clearly misplaced from time, he didn't understand the term darkspawn either. The only thing Corypheus claimed was that he was a priest of the old god Dumat, and that he personally broke into the Golden City, like in the Chantry tale. Prior to Skyhold, it was noticed that all Grey Wardens went missing around the same time the Conclave exploded. Grey Wardens are knights dedicated to fighting Darkspawn and the Blights. In order to become a Grey Warden, they must consume Darkspawn blood to gain abilities, partially becoming Darkspawn themselves. Hawk believes that Corypheus has done something to them, as his contact in the Wardens was worried about corruption on the inside. He has heard nothing from his contact since their last conversation. Hawk then leads you to where his friend may be hiding. You meet Hawk's contact in a cave in Crestwood. The contact can be three different people, depending on choices from prior games. As the contact was investigating internal corruption, all the Grey Wardens in Norlay began to experience the Calling. The Calling is when a Grey Warden is about to succumb to the Blight, thus their time is almost near. A Warden under the effect of the Calling begins to have dreams and hear whispers. Instead of completely succumbing to the Blight, the Warden then goes down to the Deep Roads and tries to take as many Darkspawn as they can with them. But in truth, Corypheus is using his connection to the Blight to influence the Wardens and make them think they are dying. Hawk's contact mentions that the Grey Warden Commander Clarel suggested a contingency plan in case all Grey Wardens were to perish. It involved the use of sacrifice and blood magic. The contact rejected this plan and then was suddenly turned on by his fellow Wardens. He then asks you to meet him at an ancient Tevinter ritual tower in the Western Approach. There, he said, you will find your answers. At the tower, you find Grey Wardens sacrificing their comrades to summon demons from the Fade and binding them to themselves. Leading this ritual is a Venatori mage. You try to convince the remaining Wardens that they are being lied to, but you are met with dead stares. The mage explains that after the mass calling, the Grey Wardens were desperate, so they began to look for help everywhere, even in Tevinter. Naturally, the Venatori were prepared to swoop in and help. He convinced the Warden Commander of a last-ditch effort plan to amass a demon army using blood magic and go down into the Deep Roads and kill the remaining slumbering old gods before they wake, thus preventing any future blights from happening, as blights are caused from Darkspawn infecting these slumbering old gods. But the Venatori's true intentions was to mind control the Wardens that bound demons by altering the ritual that they taught them slightly. The Venatori successfully took the Grey Warden's good intentions and desperation and twisted it for their own ends. A battle then breaks out and the mage escapes. Now with more information and help from Hawk's contact, a plan is made to assault the Warden base Adamant and stop Commander Clarel from going any further. Cullen and the army are successful in carving you a path to Knight Commander Clarel. When you arrive, you find her in the midst of a ritual, trying to summon a very large demon, sacrificing even more Grey Warden warriors. They believe they are doing their duty by any means necessary. Even if the whole world turn against them, they will stop the Blight. It is their duty. The Venatori mage continues to play on this feeling, attempting to fight any accusations of corruption. Eventually, you make headway with Clarel, and she tells the mage that she would like to test him on these accusations to avoid any further bloodshed. The mage drops the act instantly and destroys any trust he built up by directly summoning the archdemon to attack the base. Clarel, shocked by the image and the realization of what she's done, attacks the mage. He is hit directly and quickly gets up to run away. Clarel chases after him. When you catch up, you find the two fighting on the edge of a collapsed bridge.
You've destroyed the Grey Wardens.
You did that to yourself, you stupid bitch. All I did was dangle a little power before your eyes, and you couldn't wait to get your hands bloody. You have served a new god.
I will never serve the Blight.
When falling off the bridge, it seems as though you instinctively opened a rift to the Fade. Everyone is in shock, as no one has physically been in the Fade since the first mages who caused the Blight. Looking at your surroundings, you can see a rift in the distance. This is most likely the rift Clarel opened when she was trying to summon the large demon. You and your companions agree the best course of action is to head towards that rift and attempt to get back to the real world. Further in, you find a woman, Divine Justinia. But quickly, as you talk to her, it is evident that it is not truly Divine Justinia. Hawk tries to get more information out of the being, but it simply states it is here to help. It informs you that Corypheus has allied itself with a very powerful demon that gorges itself on people's fears. It is this demon that took away your memories of what happened at the Conclave. It is also responsible for the mass false calling that terrified the wardens. The helpful being suggests that before you make your escape from the Fade, you must recollect your lost memories. In the first memory, you can see Grey Wardens binding Divine Justinia for sacrifice. Corypheus walks into the room and begins to use the Elven Orb on her. Justinia screams for help. You then run into the room to see what the commotion was. Distracted by your entrance, Justinia uses this opportunity to smack away the elven orb. It rolls towards your direction, and you instinctively pick it up. Corypheus lunges at you, but you surge with power, and the explosion happens. This is how you attained the anchor. The being explains that Corypheus intended to rip open the veil and use the anchor to enter the Fade and throw open the gates to the Black City, believing it will give him godhood. But there is a very good chance he will just cause another calamity akin to the Blight. The being then moves on ahead, suggesting for you to collect more memories, and warns you that the demon now knows you're in the Fade. In your next memory, it clearly replays your escape from the Fade. When you were found, people believe they saw a woman leading you out of the Fade. They claimed this woman was Andraste. Now it is clear that it was Divine Justinia behind you, but right before you escaped, she was taken by a demon. The being confirmed that Divine Justinia died. The being is a spirit of some sort. If it is Justinia's soul or just a spirit taking on her likeness is unclear, and it does not give answers, but it simply still wants to help. Eventually, you make your way to the rift where the fear demon awaits. Just before the battle, the spirit of Justinia sacrifices itself to delay the main body of the demon. A battle then breaks out against the Aspect. Once victorious, you rush for the exit, but the main body is returned and is in your way. You are then given a choice to have Hawk or the Grey Warden stay behind and distract it so that the others can escape. Either way, your choice successfully distracts the demon as you make your escape and close the rift behind you. The person who stayed behind is assumed dead. The remaining wardens are free from influence, and Corypheus has lost a large portion of his army. The surviving choice then heads to Weishaupt to inform the main Grey Warden base on the events that happened.
While they do that, I'll inform the wardens at Weishaupt what's happened. Best they not get caught off guard. Good luck, Inquisitor. It's been an honor. And take care of Varric for me.
Mm. Island. Alongside helping the Grey Wardens, you are able to head to Orlais to resolve the assassination plot. During the events of Inquisition, the land of Orlais is having a civil war due to a dispute in succession. While helping the mages or Templars, you have found evidence of a possible assassination plot to destabilize the land for Corypheus. The current Empress is in danger, so you and your companions attend a ball where the assassination is supposed to take place. The ball is being held as a chance for Empress Selene and her cousin, Duke Gaspard, to negotiate peace talks in an attempt to come to an agreement to stop the bloodshed. Your goal is to investigate the individuals of the peace talks and find out who is behind the assassination plot. As you attend the ball, you come across multiple strings of backstabbing, blackmailing, and murder from multiple sources. Liliana suggests that whoever is to strike at the Empress would most likely be someone close to her or at her side. She informs you that Empress Selene is quite into mysticism and has an occult advisor. Having had dealings with this mage in the past, she knows how ruthless they are and can be quite capable of anything. Liliana believes it is worth investigating. You snoop around and eventually find the mage's office. You find a letter from the Empress asking Lady M to be by her side in case Duke Gaspard tries any sort of magical tricks against her. You find nothing else of note and head back to the ballroom. But before you can enter, you are stopped by the voice of a woman.
Well, well, what have we here?
You are stopped by the Empress's occult advisor, Morrigan. She introduces herself to you and notifies you that she is aware of your activities. She hints that you two may be looking for the same prey. Recently, she found and killed an unwelcome guest from Tevinter. She believes that Empress Selene is in danger and is hesitant to leave her side. She did find a key on the person's body, but where it leads, she has no clue. But she is trusting you to find out what's going on. Morrigan believes if anything happens to the Empress, all eyes would turn to her, as she is an apostate mage and an outsider. She warns you that there are enemies everywhere, and not only from Tevinter. She then takes her leave and heads towards Empress Selene. Earlier, you heard whispers of people not coming back from the servants' quarters. So you head that way, believing the key will unlock the path. In the servants' quarters, you find many of the servants slaughtered and an assassinated nobleman. You are then attacked by Venatori assassins. You gather more evidence and build your case on who is responsible. You are then called back to the ballroom again, where you meet Duke Gaspard's sister, Florianne. She warns you that the attack is coming soon, and to head to the royal wing and meet with Duke Gaspard's head mercenary. She believes you can get more info out of him. Before you head to the quarter, you discuss what you think with your council. They discuss two options: stopping the assassination or just letting it happen. As Corypheus just wants chaos, and with a civil war still going on, he still gets that. One of these leaders must come out victorious tonight. You head towards the royal quarter and meet with the mercenary. You find him tied up. It is a trap. Florianne then walks into the room and reveals her intentions. She was the one who suggested the ball, and it was her who planned the assassination in service of Corypheus, believing he will give Florianne all of Thedas once he has ascended. She leaves the room believing the summoned demons and Venatori troops would be enough to end you. You survive the trap and gather more evidence in the royal quarter. Then the moment of the assassination arrives. No matter what you choose, Florianne is dealt with by the end, and whoever rules Orlais can vary depending on your choices. Morrigan then meets you on the balcony and informs you that she has been assigned as a liaison with the Inquisition, as they believe you will be needing her talents in the future. She makes her preparations and moves to Skyhold. After the events in Orlais and Adamant, you head back to Skyhold. When you arrive, a Chantry mother can be seen arguing with Josephine. With Orlais' war over, the Chantry's next concern is to choose the next divine. The mother believes that they require Liliana and Cassandra in order to pick the next divine, as they were Justinia's left and right hand and her most trusted advisors. She believes due to this, either of the two would be able to unite the clergy like no one before them. At this point, through the rest of the game, you can back three different people to be the next divine. Cassandra, who wishes to change things but slowly, as not to cause too much chaos. Liliana wishes to tear the whole thing down to the bottom and rebuild. And Vivienne keeps the status quo, but with more independence for mages, and the Templars under her direct control. Once the mother leaves, Josephine mentions that now Corypheus has lost his army, and his plans to cause chaos in Orlais have failed, Cullen wishes to press the attack before he can recover. Corypheus is now on the defensive, retreating to the Arbor Wilds. He is searching for something in one of the elven ruins in the area. What it is, Liliana cannot suss out. But Morrigan believes she knows what Corypheus seeks. A power ancient and dangerous. She asks you to meet her in her quarters. She shows you a large magical mirror called an Illuvian, an elven artifact from the time before the elven empire fell to humans. She believes that one of these mirrors may lie somewhere in the Arbor Wilds. She found legends of an untouched elven ruin in the area that may have an Illuvian, but it was too dangerous, so she searched elsewhere for hers. The Illuvian is a portal that leads to the crossroads, a nexus in between time and space that is connected to all other Illuvians in the world. Morrigan describes that the ancient elves left no roads behind, only ruins hidden all over the world. These Illuvians were how they traveled. Many of the mirrors have fallen into disrepair, but a few can be opened from the crossroads. Most require a key on the outside to open, a object of power or a spell. Morrigan believes that Corypheus has learned the existence of these Illuvians and wishes to enter the crossroads. As she describes, someone with immense power can tear open into the Fade much easier from there. Corypheus has summoned the last of his forces to the Arbor Wilds to secure it, then wants to enter the Fade and attain godhood. But Morrigan believes he is more likely to unleash forces that would destroy the world. While chasing Corypheus deep into the ruins, you notice he is meeting some resistance. He is battling against ancient elves who have sworn themselves to protecting this land. While dealing with the protectors, he mentions a well of souls. You look towards Morrigan for an answer, but she shrugs as she has no idea what Corypheus is speaking of. Corypheus then crosses their defenses and sets off an explosion, opening the way and killing himself. His army charges forward into the temple. As you follow, suddenly behind you, a Grey Warden begins to vomit black and transform. You witness firsthand Corypheus's ability to resurrect. It seems as though his essence is passed to any blighted creature, and then he is able to rebuild himself. Archdemons possess the same ability, but Morrigan is unsure how Corypheus attained it. Corypheus notices your presence and commands the archdemon to attack, but you are successful in getting inside the temple and sealing the entrance behind you. Once the threat is passed, you speak to Morrigan and ask questions about this Well of Sorrows. She again states that she has no idea what it is, but if Corypheus wants it, it's best to keep it out of his grasp. You then enter further into the Temple of Mithal. Morrigan gives you more information on who Mithal was. She believes that Mithal was a powerful being who elves described as a god. She is not even sure Mithal was one person, as she is described as a being of justice and motherly kindness. But on other accounts, she is described as a vengeful god, bringer of pain and agony. If Solas is in the party, his tone is a bit annoyed with Morrigan. If you ask Solas if he knows any more, he simply says that Mithal was both of these things, and neither. She was a mother, protective and fierce. He then asks to drop the subject. Morrigan then mentions that all accounts of Mithal end the same, exiled to the beyond with her brethren. According to legend, the elven gods were tricked by the Dreadwolf, and trapped in a land beyond the Fade. Many Dalish elves believe this act was the reason why the elves fell to the humans, and their gods did not save them. Further in, you find a statue of the rebel god Fenharel, the Dreadwolf. Morrigan is confused by this, and again, Solas gives an annoyed tone.
Why would this be here?
Something wrong. It depicts the Dreadwolf, Fenharel. In elven tales, he tricks their gods into sealing themselves away in the beyond for all time. Setting Fenharel in Mithal's greater sanctum is as blasphemous as painting Andraste naked in the chantry. There must be reason behind the mysteries. I refuse to believe we cannot tease them out.
For all your knowledge, Lady Morrigan, you cannot resist giving legend the weight of history. The wise do not mistake one for the other.
Further in, you see the Venatori break the floor beneath them and skip the trials ahead. You are then given a choice to follow or do the correct rituals, as Morrigan believes you should not arrive at the Well of Sorrows unprepared. Now that she is aware of the well, she does not wish for it to fall in the wrong hands, and believes she would be the best to preserve it. Further in, you're entrapped by the Guardians of the Ruins. Their leader is Abalos. He explains that they were tasked to protect the temple, and each time intruders entered, they would wake from their slumber. In the conversation, it is revealed that the Elven Empire was not destroyed by Tevinter with the rise of humans. The elves had already been warring with themselves, and by the time the temple doors closed, the time of the elves was over. He describes humans taking over like a crow feasting on a corpse. At this point, you can either work with the Sentinels or push through them. Either way, you make it to the Well of Souls and deal with the Venatori Mage Leader and vessel for the well. Afterwards, you yourself make your way to the well above, along with Abalos and Morrigan. Abalos planned on destroying the well before anyone could get to it. Morrigan disagrees and wants the power for herself, and plans to use it to destroy Corypheus. Abalos explains more of what the well is. When a servant of Mithal reached the end of their life, they would pass on their knowledge to the well. It is the collective knowledge of all of the servants of Mithal. Before you partake in the well, Abalos warns you that the price is steep, as drinking its waters will forever bind you to the will of Mithal. Morrigan believes she is in no danger, as Mithal was banished a long time ago by the Dreadwolf. Abalos quickly corrects her, stating that the Dreadwolf had no part in her murder. Morrigan is confused by this tale, as it means common elven legend is vastly incorrect. The Sentinel simply states she was betrayed by those who destroyed the temple originally. In the back, an Illuvian can be seen. Morrigan believes she was correct after all, and that the Well of Sorrows is the key to access the Illuvian. You are then given a choice on who should drink from the well. It is decided by the party that the only real candidates are yourself and Morrigan. Either way, your party takes the power of the well for themselves and escapes before Corypheus can catch you. With the knowledge from the well, you discover how to defeat Corypheus once and for all. The archdemon at his side is not truly an archdemon. It is a dragon that Corypheus invested part of his soul to. Morrigan believes he did this out of pride to emulate the gods he used to worship. Kill the archdemon, and Corypheus' ability to bounce to another body is disrupted. With the well's knowledge, you are also given power to battle against the archdemon. Depending on choices from prior games, receiving this power can play out quite differently. If the ritual was completed in Dragon Age Origins, Morrigan gives birth to a son infused with the soul of an old god. After the well, her son suddenly goes missing. You find him in the Fade, following him through an activated Illuvian. When you arrive, he is standing close to an old woman. Her name is Flemeth, Morrigan's mother. Morrigan ran away from her mother after she discovered that she extends her life by taking over the bodies of her daughters. And now, she believes she has come for her son instead. Morrigan tries to fight back, but is stopped by Flemeth's command to whoever drank from the well. It is instantly revealed that Flemeth is Mithal, and now the drinker is bound to her will.
I do not understand. How can you be Mithal?
Once I was but a woman, crying out in the lonely darkness for justice. And she came to me, a wisp of an ancient being, and she granted me all I wanted and more. I have carried Mithal through the ages ever since, seeking the justice denied to her.
Why did Mithal come to you?
For a reckoning that will shake the very heavens.
And you follow her whims? Do you even know what she truly is?
You seek to preserve the powers that were, but to what end? It is because I taught you, girl. Because things happened that were never meant to happen. She was betrayed as I was betrayed, as the world was betrayed. Mithal clawed and crawled her way through the ages to me, and I will see her avenged!
If Morrigan drank from the well, Flemeth blesses her with the power to take on the archdemon. If you drank from the well, you're able to enlist the help of a dragon that protected the altar of Mithal. In the version with the sun, Flemeth gives Morrigan an ultimatum.
As you wish, hear my proposal, dear girl. Let me take the lad, and you are free of me forever. I will never interfere with or harm you again. Or keep the lad with you, and you will never be safe from me. I will have my due.
He returns with me.
Decided so quickly.
Do whatever you wish. Take over my body now if you must, but Kieran will be free of your clutches. I am many things, but I will not be the mother you were to me.
No more dreams?
No more dreams. A soul is not forced upon the unwilling, Morrigan. You were never in danger from me. Listen to the voices. They will teach you, as I never did.
Wait!
Afterwards, everything is set. You now have the power to match the Archdemon. All that is left is to find Corypheus. You meet with your council and discuss the next steps. Either Morrigan or the dragon will distract the Archdemon while you deal with Corypheus yourself. As your council tries to figure out where he may be hiding, a bright green light envelops the room from outside. You look and you can see that the breach has been reopened. Back at the Conclave, where it all began, the House of Sacred Ashes. Corypheus is calling you out to settle things once and for all. When you arrive, he raises the ground beneath you to the sky and sends his dragon towards you, but it is interrupted by either Morrigan in dragon form or the guardian dragon you enlisted help from. The final battle begins. As you fight Corypheus, the two dragons come tumbling down. Severely weakened, you're able to help take out the fake Archdemon once and for all. Corypheus, now vulnerable, calls on all his remaining power and attempts to tear the breach further, but you are successful in stopping him and taking the elven orb. You then quickly close the breach using the orb, and with the remaining power, use it to give Corypheus what he wanted. You transport his weakened state into the Fade. But at the end of the battle, Solas can be seen distraught as he picks up the shattered elven orb. You try to comfort him, but his expression does not change. Something feels off, and if you ask him if there's more to this story, he simply says it was not supposed to be this way, and that no matter what comes, that you have his respect. You hear the calling of the rest of your companions and go to meet them. There is a strange calmness now. The sky is permanently scarred from the battle, and you turn to look behind you, and Solas is gone. You and your friends head back to Skyhold and take in this tremendous victory. Liliana pulls you aside and informs you that her people have looked everywhere and found no trace of Solas. He clearly does not want to be found, but she says she will keep looking. You spend the rest of the night with your friends celebrating, and in the final scene, it cuts to Flemeth, Nir, and Illuvian.
I knew you would come.
You should not have given your orb to Corypheus. Red Wolf.
I was too weak to unlock it after my slumber. The failure was mine. I should pay the price. But the people, they need me. I am so sorry.
I am sorry as well, old friend.
The story picks up 2 years after the defeat of Corypheus. The Inquisition has been summoned to Orlais by the new Divine. You are to meet with the leaders of Orlais and Ferelden to decide what should be done next with the Inquisition. Orle wishes to continue to work with Inquisition, but it is obvious behind the scenes they are making moves to take control. Ferelden wishes for the Inquisition to be dismantled, as they believe it has served its purpose and is no longer needed. Additionally, Skyhold is located on Ferelden soil, and having a standing army close by makes them nervous. When you arrive, Mother Giselle is the one to greet you. She gives you more information on the state of things. After 2 years, your companions have regathered at the Winter Palace to support the Inquisition. Before the council meeting goes underway, you take time to speak with your old companions and see how things have been going for them. After getting updates from your companions, you head into the palace to face the Exalted Council. No matter what, the discussions do not seem to be going well. During the debate, you are summoned by one of your informants as something desperately needs your attention. You leave to check it out, leaving Josephine behind to deal with the nobles. You find a dead Qunari warrior. It seems as though he came out of nowhere. He is clearly a frontline soldier and not a spy. The whole scene is extremely suspicious. Most of the Qunari warrior's wounds were from magic, but few from a blade. It seems as though the warrior was attacked, separated from the rest of the forces, and somehow made it to the Winter Palace before he bled out and died. Determined to find out what is going on, you look for clues around the area. You find a trail of blood that leads to a room on the second floor in the palace. Inside, you find an Illuvian. The Illuvian takes you to some old elven ruins in the middle of a valley. While exploring, with your magic mark, you're able to unseal a door. From the door, you gain visions from the past. It seems as though in the past, this was a place of rest set up by the Dreadwolf Fenharel for fleeing elven slaves. The first message is a promise that the Dreadwolf and his people guard this area, and that the runaway elves will never be bound again. In the next tower, you unlock another door and experience another vision. The next vision is about how Fenharel has been mistakenly labeled a god, but he is mortal like every other elf. From the visions, it seems as though the Dreadwolf did not want those he saved to worship him as a god. He wished to lead those who followed him willingly and by their own choice. Deeper into the ruins, you get a third vision. You see images of the Evunaris, powerful elven mages who claim themselves gods to the masses, enslaving tens of thousands. It seems as though Fenharel was teaching elves the truth of the Evunaris' lies, that they were mortal just like everyone else. In the fourth vision, it is revealed that the face tattoos Dalish elves wear are actually slave brands. Fenharel would remove these brands from his followers to oppose the Evunaris further. While exploring, the anchor begins to start acting up, discharging large amounts of energy on its own. Deep into the sanctuary, you fight through Qunari soldiers that have overtaken the ruins. It looks as though they have been here for some time. They even were able to activate the Illuvians in the area. You eventually find a report stating that the Qunari were placed in these ruins because the Illuvians here led to the Winter Palace. From the sound of it, they were using the mirrors to infiltrate the palace. There is also a report of an unknown intruder that used the Illuvians and activated the ruins' protectors. This mage was most likely the one who wounded and killed the initial Qunari warrior. You head back to speak to your council about your findings. They are confused, as the Qunari have no real reason to be using Illuvians or attack the Inquisition. Negotiations with the Exalted Council are also not going well. Currently, Orle and Ferelden are ununited in their views, but as soon as they cooperate, the current divine will have no choice but to support them. Believing the Qunari threat is more important, you head back through the Illuvian to find more information. Through the crossroads, you find another pathway that takes you into the Deep Roads. Inside, you meet a man begging you to stop the Vitasala. If you have Iron Bull with you, he explains that the Vitasala is a high-ranking Ben Hasroth agent that specializes in finding, studying, and stopping magic. The man claims that he does not care if you serve Fenharel. Someone has to stop the Vitasala. From the conversation, you gather that the Vitasala believes the Inquisition is compromised and are actually all servants of the Dreadwolf. The man describes that the Dreadwolf's agents have been sabotaging the Qunari in the crossroads, making things more difficult. The man himself is an ex-Templar that joined the Qunari after the events of Dragon Age 2. He claims that the Vitasala's plan is as mad as Meredith ever was and wants no part of it. Instead of trying to stop magic, the Vetisala is embracing it. They are mining lyrium in the Deep Roads and feeding it to their mages for a plan called Dragon's Breath, apparently to save the South. With the ex-Templar, you concoct the plan to set off explosive barrels to destroy the mine, cutting the Qunari off from their only lyrium supply. After you complete your plan, you head back to the Winter Palace and speak to your council. They're confused why the Qunari would believe that the Inquisition serves Fen Harrell. During the meeting, the Exalted Council members come in complaining that they were not warned about the Qunari corpse and that one of your men attacked a servant. You look into the matter and find that one of your elven guards attacked the servant after he would not comply. The servant was transporting a very familiar looking large barrel, the same type of explosive barrels that were in the Qunari mine. The servant tries to convince you that he was transferring wine. You can arrest either of the elves. You then report to Liliana that someone has been smuggling explosive barrels into the palace. Liliana believes that these barrels are part of the Dragon's Breath plan. She believes a Qunari invasion through the Illuvians would still have met fierce resistance, but if everyone were to die at the Winter Palace from an explosion, Orlais and Ferelden would be leaderless and vulnerable to attack. You then give Liliana a note that was found at the scene. The note are plans on where to place the explosive barrels and instructions to head to the Illuvian marked with a bookcase once their task was complete. You head to the mentioned Illuvians while Liliana has her people remove the barrels and sends word to other possible target locations to check. The Illuvian leads to a massive ancient elven library. A spirit of an archivist gives you more information on the location. This place is called the Verdithara, the living knowledge of the Empire. The location is the collective knowledge of every city and court of the ancient elven empire. The elves created this pocket dimension connecting their world through the Fade. But when the veil was created, separating the Fade and world, the Verdithara became fractured and unstable. You ask the spirit if it has seen the Vetisala, and it says it has. The Vetisala has been gathering information, researching the veil, but it does not know why. You meet fractures of this archivist spirit throughout the library, giving you more information. The first is a recording of ancient elves cursing the Dreadwolf for creating the veil, revealing as well that the Fade and the waking world used to be one and the same until his actions. The second spirit describes the events that happened after the veil was created. The Dreadwolf suddenly disappeared, and elven society began to crumble as their connection with magic was severely weakened due to the veil. Deep into the library, you catch up to the Vetisala. The Vetisala believes that now that Corypheus is gone, that you should not be able to walk free. She also hints that she may know more what's happening with the anchor, as she notes that she can see the mark pains you. The Vetisala believes the chaos in the south is proof that those not under the Qune cannot control their magic. So she planned to kill all the heads of state at once to take control. But the followers of Fen Harrell disrupted her plans. You try to ask why she thinks the Inquisition has ties to the Dreadwolf, but she ignores you and sends her minions to try and finish you off. After the battle, you follow, but she is long gone. The spirit in the area informs you where she went, a location called Davarad. You then head back to inform your council of your findings. Liliana confirms that explosives were found in multiple key locations across Thedas. The Winter Palace was not the only target. Josephine is positive this situation will show the Exalted Council the Inquisition still has value, but Liliana believes things will most likely get worse, as the explosives were brought in through the Inquisition. Your own people have been compromised. Liliana investigated and noticed several elven workers have gone missing recently. A background check showed the elves were refugees from Kirkwall. Cullen then notes that many of the elves converted to the Qune, looking for a better life after the horrors they experienced in Kirkwall. Thus, the Qunari most likely converted many of these elves to spies. Josephine is upset as she has defended the Inquisition against the Exalted Council. But now with all that is going on, she is starting to have doubts. Your council begins to argue, but then your hand starts to surge with energy again, causing you massive amounts of pain. It is getting worse. You leave your council to handle matters as you head to Davarad to find the Vetisala. You arrive at an Illuvian graveyard. There are hundreds of mirrors scattered about. It seems as though the Qunari have been studying these mirrors for quite some time now. You fight through the Qunari base until you reach another Illuvian in the back. Before the Vitasala enters it, she takes some time to confront you. Your mark is discharging even more energy now. She says that your time is almost up, and that if the agents of Fen'Harel are not stopped, they too may shatter the world. You try to get through to her that you're not working with Fen'Harel, but she ignores you and begins to state the information she gathered from her spy.
The Inquisition has nothing to do with these agents.
Come, Inquisitor. I am the eyes and ears of the Qunari people. Do you think you can deceive me? You would have died from the mark on your hand, but for the help of one of their chief agents. The same agent who helped seal the breach, who led you to Skyhold, who gave Corypheus the orb, then founded the Inquisition. Solus, agent of Fen'Harel.
Damn it, Chuckles. What have you done?
You are in shock. The Vitasala surprised you knew so little. She states Solus tricked everyone. He was the one who pushed the dying Qunari warrior through the Illuvian, thus luring you into a confrontation and foiling her plans. She had her way, or Leia and Ferelden would have fallen quickly, but now they will have to do it the old-fashioned way, a full-scale invasion. Your mark begins to discharge, bringing you to your knees. She leaves into the Illuvian, promising Solus will not outlive you. You follow her through the Illuvian. The Vitasala is after Solus. The Illuvian leads to more ancient elven ruins. Hordes of Qunari troops are in your way. You do not have much time left, as your mark is rapidly increasing in power. You battle your way through the ruins until you reach the final Illuvian and enter. Inside, you see dozens of Qunari troops turn to stone. You catch up to the Vitasala and Solus. Solus tells her to leave and to warn the Qunari to trouble him no further. He then turns to walk away, but the Vitasala attacks. Solus instantly turns her into stone. You walk up from behind and call out to him, your mark bringing you down to your knees. Solus casts a spell to alleviate the pain for now. He knows you may have many questions. The mark was bestowed by the orb of Fen'Harel, his orb. He reveals that he is indeed the Dreadwolf himself, Fen'Harel. His true name is indeed Solus, but he was later named Fen'Harel by others. In his time, the Dreadwolf inspired hope to his friends and fear in his enemies. You ask if the legends of Fen'Harel are true. He confirms that he sought to free his people from the Avunaris and freed anyone who wished to join him. When the Avunaris murdered Mithal, Solus formed the Veil and banished them forever, but in doing this, caused the collapse of the Elven Empire. He believes that if he had not created the Veil, the Avunaris would have eventually destroyed the entire world. Solus reawoke to the world a year before he joined the Inquisition. He regrets the damage the creation of the Veil did to his people and seeks to restore them, even if it means the current world must die. You try to convince Solus, but he sees no other way. The original plan was to have Corypheus unlock the orb, as Solus was too weak at the time. Then, after he perished from the explosion, Solus would recover the orb and tear down the Veil. In that chaos, Solus planned to restore the world of the elves, but he did not realize Corypheus unlocked the secret of immortality, complicating his plans. Solus takes no joy in what he believes he has to do. Rather than the world fall to the Qun from a Qunari invasion, would rather people live out their last years in comfort. Your mark begins to act up again. Solus was able to stop it for now, but it will eventually kill you. He gives his farewells and walks away into an Illuvian. Some time passes, and you walk into the Exalted Council, now missing your left arm. You're then given a choice on how to continue with the Inquisition. Everyone is now aware of the threat posed by Solus and his followers. Your choice will affect corruption in the Inquisition and how strong your efforts against Solus will be. And in the final scene, we see our Inquisitor planning their next move.
We have what we truly need.
We will need to be careful.
Solus knows everything about us. Who we are, how we work, our strengths, and weaknesses.
Then we find people he doesn't know. We will save our friend from himself, if we can.